So today I would like you to talk about zero knowledge proofs. So the reason why I would like to talk to you about that is that today there are a lot of useful technologies coming out. So more and more technologies are very great, but they have the big drawback that they need your data. And your data can actually be pretty private or sensitive. In that scope, actually, privacy enhancing technologies aims to let you have both. So you can benefit from modern technologies without having to give back your data. Or on the other way around, you can have your privacy without having to go back to the Stone Age, for instance. And one nice example of privacy enhancing technologies is the zero knowledge proof. And it's the thing I'm going to talk about you today. What actually zero knowledge proofs are, they are protocol which let a prover, let's say me, to prove you a statement about a secret without actually giving up that secret. So I can prove you that I know a secret and something about that secret without revealing that secret. So this is how it works in general, but an easy way to understand the intuition beyond zero knowledge proof is actually the game with these two pens. So I will give you these two pens, and the idea is that you are colorblind and you cannot distinguish which one is the red and which one is the blue. But you don't believe me. You think that actually there are no way to distinguish this pen. And now I would like to prove you that these pens are actually distinguishable without giving away the information of which one is the blue and which one is the red. So I don't want you to know which one is the red, which one is the blue, but still be sure that you believe me when I say these two are not equal.
So how does it work?
So I will give you these two pens in random order. Mm-hmm. And now I will ask you to put it behind your back and to swap your hands. Either you do, either you don't, at randomly.
As far as I'm concerned, I don't know if this is blue or this is red. These
exactly.
are just two pens that look the same to me.
You are colorblind.
Okay.
But right. I can distinguish them.
Okay, so putting these behind my back.
You swap her or you don't.
And they come back.
And now I can tell you, you didn't swap the pens. So now, you actually kind of believe me, but you're not really sure because I could have simply said it at random. I had a 50% chances to guess the right answer. So let's say do it again.
All right, okay, going behind my back and yeah.
Now I can say you swapped the pen. So now you're a little bit more convinced because you know that I could have cheated only with a chance of 25%. And that's the idea behind zero knowledge proof. We can repeat that experiment as often as you like, decreasing the probability to 12.5% and so on until you're fully convinced that I couldn't have cheated about that. This is the first example, and I have a second one to make things absolutely clear. It's about these cards. So let's say that we have a classic card deck of 52 cards, and I'll take like one randomly from this. And now I would like to prove you that this card is actually red, but I don't want to give away the information about the number on that card and nothing else about that card. How does it work to convince you about that without giving away the number? So I will simply put that here so you can see it, and I take the other one. Now what I will do is I will show you exactly 26 cards that are actually black. So now you can count them. And if you do, you will notice that if there are here 26 cards which are black, this one here must be red. So this is a nice example on how zero knowledge proof works and the intuition behind that. To make the thing a little bit more mathematical for people that may like it, zero knowledge proofs actually have three criteria. If the protocol respects these three criteria, you can say, okay, I did a zero knowledge proof. The first is correctness. It simply states that if both people are honest, so if I'm honest and you are honest, everything works fine. The second one is soundness. It's also kind of obvious. It means that if I don't know the secret, I cannot prove the statement and I cannot prove that I know the secret. So with the example of before, if I couldn't recognize the color of the pens, I couldn't be able to tell you if you swap or not the pens behind your hand. And the third one is what makes the whole point of having zero knowledge proofs, is the characteristic called zero knowledge in itself. It means that after following the protocol, you learn nothing more than the statement that I wanted to prove you. So in the example of the card, you learn nothing more that the card here is actually red. Nothing, no side information. That's the whole point. How can you use zero knowledge proofs in real life? So an example for that, a very nice one, is about e-voting. How to use a zero-knowledge proof to make e-voting works fine. So let's say that we want to vote for an election which has two candidates. The two candidates are the pen that we had before, and have two envelopes here, and my vote. Let's say I want to vote for the pen on the right here. What I do is I'll write a 1 here and a 0 here. Now I put my vote inside the envelope, and putting the vote inside the envelope actually means encrypting them using a specific type of scheme, which is not the scope of that video. So the vote 1, which means I want to vote for pen blue, I put it here, and 0, I don't want to vote for this pen here. Now, how does it work? You do the same.
Okay, so I have to write 1 and 0.
1 and 0, and you put them here.
Do you have to look away at this time?
Yes.
Okay, let's get my 1 and then 0. There we go.
And so, everybody does his vote in such a way. The envelope means that the votes are encrypted. The idea is that at the end, we use a protocol to aggregate the results inside all the envelope without revealing particularly each vote. We will only reveal the sum, all the votes having blue and all the votes for red. But if we do that, there is many ways that we, the voter, can cheat. The first thing we could do actually is not write 0 and 1. And the election is all about voting for exactly one candidate, not both and not none of them. So the first zero knowledge proof we could include inside that e-voting protocol is the proof that the sum of our votes, so the sum of the things that are inside your envelope, sum up to 1, which means you voted for exactly one candidate. But now, imagine that you were about cheating, and what you did was you put -1 in one envelope and +2 in the other one. The sum is still 1, but you could not do that. So a second zero knowledge proof you should add to the protocol is the proof that the encrypted values are binary, so either 0 or 1. So it makes 2 zero knowledge proofs. And now let's say another one, which is also optional. Let's say for instance that I know nothing about Penn's politics, but I do know that you know a lot about it. So what could I do is I take your envelope, your previous vote, I copy paste it without knowing what's inside, and then I vote it on top of it. So to avoid that, the third zero knowledge proof would be to prove that I actually know the inside of the envelope, that I actually know what am I voting for. And this mitigates the three problems that we could have with naive e-voting. This is one of the examples, and this could be applicated actually in the same way for signing petitions online, for e-petitioning system. So it's an idea where you can vote electronically, so having the benefits of technology without giving away your privacy.
When you mentioned looking inside and checking that things are binary and add up to 1, people could look inside those anyway, could they? Or is there a special protocol that...
No, so actually the envelope here are not really envelope. These are encryption of what is inside. So there is no way to decrypt it. And no one is really willing to and has not the possibility to decrypt each single vote. You can only decrypt once all the votes have been summed up. So there is no way to recover which person voted for which pen at the end. There is only a way to know that the person actually did a binary vote, which is also summed up to 1, and that he knew the content of the vote.
This is part of the encryption protocol, is it?
Yeah, the second part is part of the zero knowledge protocol that comes over and works with the encryption protocol. The idea is that the fact that the vote is binary is your statement, but the vote's content is your secret. So it's still in the definition of zero knowledge proof about proving you a statement about the secret without revealing you the secret.
So for instance, the fact that the card is red, back in our cards example, but not what the number is, right?
Exactly, yes, that's an example. Or also, the secret is my vote, so the secret is it 0 or 1? I don't tell you that, but I want to tell you the statement that it is binary. Then there would be no energy cost to computing.
No energy cost?
No energy cost. Because here's the fascinating thing, what costs the energy is not the computation itself, it's a raising information.